What would the world be like without teachers?
Chaos.
Sad. Because I won't learn anything.
The younger generation wouldn't have anyone to look up to learn from.
Walk around ignorant.
I mean, we could keep the teachers, but just no homework. That'd be pretty cool.
Everybody would be going cuckoo and we wouldn't know anything.
I think that is the scariest thought that anyone could ever have.
I think it would be craziness just because I feel like teachers are, besides our parents, the first people we meet who like shape who we become.
My name is Mr. Joseph Ozo Uchechukwu. I graduated from Imo State University and I read animal and environmental biology in my first degree. Then, due to my interest and zeal in the field of biology, I decided to proceed to complete my master's in medical parasitology and entomology. And since after my master's, I've been very much interested in teaching. I have taught at several extramural centers and other higher institutions on part-time basis. I've also taught in secondary schools. We are going to embark on serious biology practicals, where I will expose the students on how to use some of the laboratory equipment we have in the lab to teach the life practicals in biology so that they have that pragmatic approach to biology so that it will be very easy for them to pass in their exams.
Keep watching.
You are going to enjoy the teaching as well as the processes that are going to be involved.
So we are going to teach the students how to describe some of the biological specimens to enable them to answer the why questions properly. Students have to know some aspects of the specimens in practical biology. Some aspects of these specimens include the views, the sections, the symmetry, and the magnification of the specimen you are given to draw or you are given to describe in the exam. You have to know the views, sections, symmetry, and magnification of the specimen you are given to draw in the exam. I want to use this opportunity to tell you or to draw your attention to what you mean by view. In practical biology, every specimen that is given to you has view. That is, view in this case has to do with the part or the region from which the specimen given to you is observed. When you observe the specimen from the back, That is what you call the dosal view. The dosal view. If you are asked to draw the dosal view of a specimen or to describe the dosal view of a specimen, it means you are going to turn the back of the specimen and describe the back side of the specimen. Then specimen also has what we call ventral view, which is the abdominal side, the abdomen. So when you are given a particular specimen and you are asked to describe the ventral view, it means you are going to turn the abdominal side of the specimen and examine it. And that is what is called the ventral view. The ventral view. We also have what we call lateral view, which is the side of the specimen. Lateral view. When you watch the specimen from the side, you will draw and describe some of the features you will see or you will observe. Then, posterior view, which is the tail region of the specimen, is described as the posterior view. Posterior view is the tail region. So you may be asked to draw the posterior view of a tilapia fish. Then you draw the tail side or the tail region of the tilapia fish. When you are asked to describe the side view or the lateral view, that is from the side of the specimen. When you are asked to describe the ventral view, you draw the abdominal side. When you turn the back of the specimen and view it, that is called the dorsal view. We also have what is called the anterior view, which is the head region. The head region of the specimen is known as anterior view. So students have to know the views of specimens in order for them to describe the specimen that are given in the exam hall properly. So I believe as this practical is going on, we shall exemplify some of the things I have said here, and I'm going to demonstrate. We are going to bring specimens and give to the students for them to see what we mean by side view, ventral view, posterior view, anterior view. This class goes on, you will be able to know these views. Now, sections. Let's talk about the sections of the specimen. This is the area that many students find it difficult to explain. When you are asked to describe the section or to draw a particular section of the specimen given to you, especially plant specimens, a good number of students find it difficult to describe these sections. Some of the sections we have in biology include transverse section. Transverse section. This is otherwise known as the cross section. This is otherwise known as the cross section. A student may be asked to draw the transverse section of an orange fruit. Draw the transverse section or the cross section of an orange fruit and label it. So many students at this point will find it difficult to draw the transverse section. So this is another aspect of the specimen students should be exposed to. As this class goes on, you will see how to draw and label the transverse section of biological specimen. For instance, if a student is asked to draw the transverse section of an orange fruit, you have to know that transverse section simply means cutting the fruit across. Cutting it across. If you have an orange fruit, the whole orange fruit, instead of cutting it lengthwise, you cut it across. And when you cut it across, I told you, when you are asked to draw the transverse section of an orange fruit, this is an orange fruit. So what you will do is to cut this orange across. transversely. Don't cut it along. So you cut it across, you get the transverse section. With a sharp knife, you cut the orange across. And when you cut it across, you will draw the surface as you are seeing it. You will draw it exactly the way it is, or the way it appears on the surface. That is what we mean by transverse section. So in practical biology exams, students will be asked to draw cross section of fruits, seeds, and other specimens. So what you will do is to cut across and draw the surface as you see it. Then when you are asked to draw the longitudinal section, which is also called the vertical section. You will cut the fruit along lengthwise from top to bottom. You cut it lengthwise instead of across. So when you cut a fruit or a specimen lengthwise, vertically from top to bottom, that is what is called the longitudinal section. So these sections are very, very important in practical biology. So students are expected to know what we mean by transverse section and cross sections, and the longitudinal section or vertical section. So now let's talk about symmetry. Symmetry. Now, symmetry is the equal distribution of the parts of a specimen on opposite sides of a line drawn from the center of that specimen. What does that mean? For instance, this orange fruit, you may be asked, what type of symmetry does it possess? So what you are going to do is, this orange fruit has a center. So if you are able to cut this orange fruit into two parts, and the structures of this orange fruit found in this part is also found in this other part, then that orange fruit is said to possess what is called bilateral symmetry. So symmetry has to do with the distribution of body parts on opposite sides of a line drawn from the center of the specimen. That's what the symmetry is all about. It has to do with the distribution of body parts of an organism on both sides of a line drawn from the center. We have different kinds of symmetry. We have bilateral symmetry. We have radial symmetry. We have pentaradial symmetry. We have spherical symmetry. We also have asymmetry. These types of symmetries will be demonstrated when we embark on the real examination of specimens as this practical goes on. Students will be made to understand what each type of this symmetry is. Then the next aspect of the specimen which students must know is magnification. This one is very important. Magnification is very, very important. So magnification is the enlargement of the size of the specimen. So the increase or the enlargement of the size of the specimen. So when a student is given a particular specimen in exam to draw, after drawing, that student is expected to write down the magnification or the size of the specimen given to him or her. For instance, if a student is asked to draw and label a cockroach 10 cm long, student is asked in the exam to draw and label a cockroach 10 cm long. So what that student we do is to measure out with the meter rule the length stated in the question paper, which is 10 cm, and draw it in the answer booklet. And after drawing, that student has to measure the real size, the actual size of the cockroach. Measure it with the meter rule. And after getting the size of the cockroach, that's the natural size, or the actual size of the cockroach, then the student is going to divide the size of the drawing with the size, the actual size of that cockroach, in order to get the actual magnification. And that magnification must be written under the diagram. For instance, after drawing a diagram and the student is asked to write down the magnification, or the student is supposed to write the magnification, the magnification of the cockroach now becomes size of the drawing divided by this natural size, or the actual size of the specimen. For instance, if a student is asked to draw the cockroach 10 cm long, then the size of the drawing is 10 cm. And the student has to measure the cockroach natural length with the meter rule. And assuming it is a 5 cm, the cockroach is 5 cm long, then the magnification of that cockroach now is 2. And this is written as magnification times 2. And this should be written under the diagram. This means that the size of that cockroach has been increased 2 times. We have another type of magnification, which is a microscope magnification. In that case, when a student observes a specimen under a microscope, then the magnification of the specimen observed is obtained by multiplying the eyepiece magnification with that of the objective lens in order to get the actual size or the magnification of the specimen being viewed. For instance, if the eyepiece of a microscope has the magnification of times 10 and that of the objective is times 40, then the magnification of the specimen viewed should be 10 times 40, which is 400. This simply means that when the specimen is observed under the microscope, the microscope has increased the size of that tiny object about 400 times. And that will make the scientist observe the real nature and the structure of the specimen. The personal and the general laboratory safety policies, which students and researchers working in the lab must observe. For you to work in the laboratory environment, you must observe the personal and general laboratory safety in order not to harm yourself in the lab. Some of these laboratory safety policies, we are going to talk about them. One, never eat, drink, smoke, or otherwise while working in the laboratory. Don't eat, drink, or smoke in the laboratory because it's dangerous. There are some dangerous fumes in the lab, some dangerous chemicals and gases. So it's not expected that while working in the lab you'll be eating, because these things may be introduced into the mouth. They are harmful. You don't smoke in the lab. Number 2, read labels carefully. Immediately you enter the laboratory environment, you have to read the labels to know, to be conversant with the equipment the chemicals, to know their names, to know those that are dangerous, to know those that are liquids, and to know those that are harmless too. So you need to read labels to know and to observe the simple rules and regulations written on the specimens, on the bench, on the walls. That will guide you and safeguard you in the lab. Number three, do not use any equipment unless you are trained and approved as a user by your supervisor. Students are not expected to enter the lab and start using any equipment they see, any instrument they see, because they may be harmful. Some of them are electrical appliances. Some of them are meant to be used by people that are enlightened. So students are not expected to enter the lab and begin to operate any instrument they see in the lab. It's very dangerous. Number four, wear safety glasses or face shield when working with hazardous material or equipment. Yes, whenever a student is working in the lab or a biologist is working in the lab, he has to wear protective shields to prevent contact with dangerous gases and the fumes. Number five, wear gloves when using any hazardous or toxic agents. It is advisable to wear hand gloves. So as we enter into real practicals, we are going to wear our gloves, put on our lab coats, and begin to perform the live practical as it's supposed to be, to avoid contact with some dangerous chemicals. Number six, clothing. When handling dangerous substances, wear laboratory coats and the safety shed, as I said before. We need to put on these things on for protective purposes. Obtain permission before operating any electrical appliance. That's number seven. You don't just enter the lab and begin to operate any electrical appliance or any equipment in the lab without permission from the laboratory attendant. Number eight, if you have long hair or loose clothes, this one concerns women or females working in the lab, they need to tie up their long hair so that it will not contact any nearby chemical or maybe something that is very harmful or dangerous chemicals may stain their hair, and from there they will contact one problem or the other. Number nine, never pipette anything by mouth. We have pipettes in the lab, which we use to pipette some chemicals. So students are not expected to enter the lab and begin to pipette chemicals without permission or without knowing how to do it, because they may swallow chemicals accidentally, and this is dangerous. And then finally, you do not walk. Do not walk lonely in the lab whenever possible. This means that as students enter the lab, they are not expected to walk in the lab lonely. You have to enter in group when others are there and perform the experiments and leave when others are leaving. It's very dangerous because if anything happens to you, you may not have any way of escape and nobody may save you. And anytime you leave the lab, try to lock it up, close the windows, close the doors, and keep all your equipment in the lab in correct position to avoid any harm or accident in the lab.